So, what we're going to do is, I have this drum set here that's a kind of a unique, special drum set, and I think everybody here will find this to be pretty interesting because it looks very different than any other drum set that you've probably ever seen. And I haven't used it in a while, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to set it up. But while I'm setting it up, I'm going to talk to you guys about things related to this particular drum set. I'll also talk to you about things having to do with the setup of any drum set so you guys can learn stuff. I'll be talking about how to set up for a gig, and by gig I mean like for a performance. There are some things that you might need to think about in a performance that you normally wouldn't think about when you're practicing. So I'll be talking about all these sort of things. Hey guys. Hey. What you guys can sit over here. So, as I do this, if a question comes to your mind, feel free to raise your hand and I'll call on you if it's a good time for me to answer questions while I'm doing things. I do want you to ask questions while I'm doing this, because you might ask a question that might have to do with something that I'm not thinking about telling you about. So I'm wanting you to learn as much as you can while we're doing this, okay? All right, so first things first is this is my entire drum set. Now compare that to that over there. Doesn't it seem like impossible to set up that full-size drum set to this much stuff? So what I have here is a pretty unique drum set. All the drums fit into this bag, all the hardware fits into this bag, and all of the cymbals fit into this bag. And the reason why I have this set up is, as you can see, I can load everything up and it's one trip to wherever I'm going. And that sure does beat having to carry 7, 8, 9, 10 different separate bags for drums and cymbals and things. Because that's a lot of trips, right? So when you're a gigging musician, when part of your job is playing music and having to move stuff around, it's really helpful to make it as easy as possible on yourself. And there's two ways you can approach that. One is by having instruments that are light, and also instruments that are compact. And by compact, I mean like they can compact very small, which is what I have here. So, first thing I'm going to do is, if I'm setting up a drum set, I need to know if I'm setting up on carpet, or if I'm setting up on tile, or if I'm setting up on a wood floor, or on concrete, or grass, or whatever, right? Here's why. Because if I'm setting up on carpet like this is cool. Like, I can set my drum set up and won't slide around, and it's not dirty, so my drum set's going to be fine. But if I'm setting up on like dirt, my drum set can move around while I play. It can sink into the dirt. You guys get the idea? Now if I'm setting up on concrete, the concrete can scratch my drum set. It also might slide around on the concrete because the bass drum legs can't dig into the concrete. Or if it's wood or tile, kind of the same thing. I could scratch up the tile, I could scratch up the wood, the drum set can slide around. Carpet's really what you want, right? Now sometimes if you're setting up in dirt, you want to lay down a piece of plywood first or something like that and then put carpet on top of it. So even though I already have carpet here, I want to show you that I keep a carpet with me because I never know if the place that I'm playing at has a carpet or not. Plus, this carpet is about the size of my drum set, so it kind of gives me an idea of where my drum set's going to be when I start setting up. And that way anybody who plays any other instruments like guitars or bass or saxophone or whatever, they know where I'm going to be so I can work on setting up my stuff and they can work on setting up around. There's been plenty of times where a guitar player or a bass player has started setting up their stuff before I even got my carpet in place and they had to move all of their gear because I had to fit somewhere. Okay? All right, so now that that's done, I am going to, set up the core of the drum set first, which starts with the bass drum, so we'll get to that in a second. My bass drum requires three special parts. And I gotta find it. Gotta find the other thing. Alright, these are my two bass drum legs. So if you look at that bass drum over there, you see two legs that come off either way to keep it from rolling around. So that's what these are. This is a lift, and you'll see what that does in a minute. But that lift has a plate, and this is where the bass drum pedal hooks onto. So all my hardware's in here. And all my drums are in here. Now I keep these with me. This goes on the base room head that I hit with the beater to help muffle that base room head. And then this is a towel that I use for the other base room head, and there's a hole in that head, and I'll show you in a minute, where I can pull this and put it up against the front head to muffle it more if I want to. All right, let me see if I can do this though. Normally what I do is I take this apart while it's still in the bag, but I want to see what's going on. So I am going to do something I would normally do. So I'm gonna flip this over so I can get everything out of that. All this was in the bag, this is what it would look like, okay? There are three clips on this part of the drum. So now you can take this off. And inside of this drum, you have this bag. And inside of this bag, you have the small tom-tom. Snare drum, and then the big tom-tom. So what's really cool is it all fits inside of one bag. That's what makes it easy to transport. It is kind of heavy having all those drums inside of each other, but that's why I put it on the cart. Okay, so this guy. So this actually has four legs. You have these that look like the legs that are on most bass drums. And I think you guys can see from where you're at. This leg has rubber. Now the idea for that rubber piece is if you pull it down, is so that if you're like on a hardwood floor or something like that, it won't slide around. But in my experience, that never works. So I just don't even bother using this. So I retract the rubber part so the spike comes out. And so this spike is going to be what digs into the carpet to keep from moving around. And let me tell you this, if you think any of this is boring, whenever you get a drum set or if you already have a drum set and you go to set it up somewhere and you discover that your drum set is sliding around on you or scratching up your parents' floor, all this stuff I'm telling you is going to help you with all that. That's where it becomes useful, okay? It's kind of like doing cleaning your bed, like doing your laundry with your bed is probably not very fun. But if you don't know how to do it, then you're always gonna be sleeping in a dirty bed. Setting up your drum set might not seem that interesting, but if you don't know how to set it up, then you're always gonna be frustrated with it. All right. So then, my bass drum. Now remember when I was talking about this being a lift? You'll notice that the bass drum is actually a lot smaller than a normal size bass drum. So it has to be lifted up in the air in order for me to have the bass drum pedal get put on it correctly. Does that make sense? Cool. So now that I have that, I'm going to start putting the toms on there. Actually, before I do that, I'm going to put a bass drum pedal on. Now, I always bring two bass drum pedals with me, if I can, to every gig I go to. Why might I do that? Does anybody have any idea? Exactly. She said, in case one isn't working. I've had situations where I've had springs pop off and break, or screws come loose and I lose them on stage, so the bass drum pedal's just flopping around and not working anymore. So if you have a spare bass drum pedal, then you can just switch them out really quick and you can worry about finding your parts or fixing your parts later. That's one of the pieces that tend to go first. All right, so we got the bass drum set up and this drum set has three arms. Most drum sets have two that go here where two toms hang off of it. And then you have a snare drum stand for a snare, and you have a floor tom over here. This is set up a little bit differently. And the problem that I have is sometimes I forget which arm goes where, but I was smart, I numbered them. This says two, so I'm gonna put it here in the second position. This one, says three, so that's gonna go there. And this says one, somewhere. So that goes there. Now, I wanna point something out to you guys. You notice these are all different lengths and at different angles and stuff. This is all things that I can adjust. And once they're adjusted, I can lock them down with these clamps. This right here is called a memory lock. You clamp it there and that memorizes how deep this goes into the drum. So I don't have to adjust this anymore for the height. Also, there's little notches under here that fit into notches here so that you can remember like what position it's supposed to be in. So obviously I don't want the drum over there because I can't reach it. So I always set the memory locks up so they're straight with me so that I can remember where they're supposed to be. All right, so we're gonna do these and this one here. And by the way, this is a drum set that you cannot buy anymore unless you buy them used from somebody because they stopped making these. This is called a hip gig. It's made by Yamaha. And this particular version of it is a signature version for a guy named Al Foster, who, to be honest with you, I don't know very much about, and I should probably take the time to learn more about him. But he's a professional drummer and designed this kit. And usually if drum sets stop being produced, it's because they went out of style. So I guess they decided that making these today isn't something they can make money off of, so they stopped making it. But I kept mine and I still really dig it. All right, so now we got the three drums on there. We got the snare drum, small tom, and large tom. Now I mentioned to some of you earlier that this is a drum set I use when I'm gigging regularly with certain types of bands. And I haven't been in a band that uses this kind of kit in a while, but I'm in a band now that's gonna use this drum set. We're probably gonna start gigging in the next few weeks. So I have to do things to this drum set, and I figured I'd take the opportunity to do it to the drum set while teaching you guys at the same time. So one of the things I will be doing is tuning the drum set. All right, so we got this stuff set up. Now I'm gonna take these guys and put them on. This one goes right up here against this drum head. And then this one I'm just gonna put right there because I'm gonna grab it through this hole. Now, before I do this, I actually need to replace the drum head. I had this drum head made for me. And the reason why I chose this background is just because I thought it was pretty cool looking, like a piece of art. And the reason why I also chose it is I figured the blue might pop off that yellow. And part of being a musician is entertaining people, so this is just something kind of cool to look at for bass drum art. And the reason why I put my website on there is I want people to know who I am and be able to find me if they want to look me up for something. So I need to put that here. So probably the easiest way to do this is to actually put this bass drum piece back on. It goes like that. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take my drum key. Drum key is a tool that you use to adjust all of your tension rods, which is how you tune drum heads, but also some of the moving parts, like these memory blocks, require the drum key as well. So what I'm going to do first is I'm going to loosen all these tension rods so that I can turn it with my fingers, because I can actually turn it faster with my fingers than I can with this drum key, but starting out, it's too tight, so I have to loosen it with the drum key first. So what I'm doing is multitasking right now. I'm loosening tension rods with this one, and then I'm completely taking it apart with my other hand. Otherwise, you're sitting here all day and turning this thing.
So when you said that you're going to be playing with a band where you use this kit, what makes this band, what kind of music?
That's a good question. I've played in a lot of bands over the years, And one of the bands that I was known for playing in for a long time in this town is a band called Whiplash. They're a heavy metal band, and the drum set that I used for that band was a big, large, double bass drum kit with a bunch of tom-toms and a bunch of cymbals. It's just a huge drum set. That's the kind of drum set you want to use for really heavy music, like rock music. But the band that I'm going to be using this for is a band that does cover songs of stuff that you hear on the radio. So if you like Maroon 5, or Katy Perry, who else is popular right now? You know, any of those kind of groups, anything you hear on the radio, country music, like Jason Aldean or Luke Bryan, like anything that's more popular in nature, that you wouldn't use a big drum set for that, you would use a smaller drum set. Now a drum set like this one, that's a pretty normal sized drum set, that would be fine for this kind of thing. I like this one better because it's not quite as loud, and the drums are a little punchier sounding, like they cut across a little better. It's easier to tune, and obviously it's really easy to move around. So that's what this drum set's for. This drum set is also a great drum set for like jazz music, small jazz playing. Gosh. This is the original head. I bought this drum set. I'm gonna embarrass TJ. When he was a baby, no, you were probably two. When I saw this drum set was available from a place in Tampa, put him in the car in his car seat. We drove down to Tampa. Just as we pulled into the drum shop, he threw up all over the car. And then you had to throw up all over your shirt, and I cleaned you up the best that I could. And so I went into the store to talk to the guys about this drum set, and you were running around literally hitting everything in the entire store while I was trying to talk to these guys about this drum set. But anyway, when he was about two, that's when this was when I bought all this. And this is the original drum head. I've never taken it off. So it's about time to change it anyway. All right, so now we're gonna put this on here. Word of advice, if you're ever taking a rim off of any drum, especially if it's been a while, I like to clean it while I have it off. A general cleaner is fine, or like Windex, which is a window cleaner, or a glass cleaner is fine. And all I'm really trying to do is just get any dirt or dust or whatever off of it. And I want you to notice that I'm leaving all the tension rods dangling on there because it's kind of a pain in the butt once you take them all off and put them back on. Not that it's super hard, but it's just like another thing you have to do. All right, so now that's pretty clean. I don't know if you can see it, but it's dirt all over this rag now. A little bit. And then the other thing that I will do, usually if I remember, is I'll go around the edge of the drum to get all that dust off too. All right, so let's get the head on there. Now, it's not expensive to do this with a drum head. That look pretty straight to you? Yeah? All right, so this is just a regular drum head, but what I did is I had a sign company basically print up a big sticker. This is just a sticker that they put on there. What's kind of cool about this is not only do you get an image on your drum head the way that they make it this way, but the sticker will also help to muffle this drum head a little bit too. Muffling is nice because if you don't muffle a bass drum, when you hit it, it's just going to go boom, and it's going to ring forever. Well, on a drum set bass drum, that's not what you want. You might want it to ring just a tad to get some tone out of the bass drum, but you don't want it to ring a lot. And so the only way to get rid of that ringing is by muffling it in some way. That's why I have the towels in here. But this head being the way it is, it'll muffle it a little bit anyway, which is kind of cool. Anytime you muffle a drum, you're actually cutting the volume down too. So you're not really trying to get it softer. Yeah, there's something weird with this drum head. I think I'm on that now, though. Like, that's, which way should I go, that way or this way?
This way? That good?
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, there's something weird with this head, it doesn't fit on it correctly, I might have to take this off. You guys have any questions while I'm putting this back together? How about that hole here? Does anybody know what that hole's for?
Really? Hide your stuff.
Hide your stuff?
I've done that before.
When you put a hole in the base room head like that, we call that porting the base room head. Serves a couple different purposes. One is it helps air come out of the base room quicker, so it doesn't ring as much. Something else that it does is it allows you to be able to put a microphone up inside of that, and I will be doing that today in a moment. And the reason why you would put a microphone in there is to help amplify the bass drum through a sound system. But something else that's nice is because that hole is there, I can stick my hand in that hole and move those towels around that are inside of it. Alright, so this drum head's got something weird about the size of it that doesn't make it want to stay on here very correctly, but I think I made it work. So if it works, then it works, and I'll leave it alone. Alright, so now I'm going to kind of tune it up. The first thing I do when I tune basically any drum is I try to get the drum head on there evenly. And then after that, I'll take the drum key and tune it the way that I want to tune it. Now, I'm not going to get into a huge long tuning lesson about it today. I'll just give you some general things as we go. Usually with a bass drum on this side of the drum, I actually try to keep it as loose as possible without it sounding floppy. Like when it's floppy sounding, it almost sounds like paper when you hit paper. But I don't want it so loose that it has no tone. So I might come back to that, or I might leave that alone. We'll see how we're doing on time. All right, let's talk about hardware. What am I going to sit on?
Floor.
Exactly. What am I going to sit on? All right, so your drum seat can also be called a drum throne. It's the same thing. So my drum seat fits in here. And it's already adjusted for the height that I prefer. So that's it. That's all I have to do with that. Hi-hat stand. First thing I want to do is spread these legs out. And then this right here, I can squeeze together. And those two little hooks feed into two little holes on the base of the hi-hat stand. So the hi-hat stand base is like that. Now what I always do is I lift this part off the ground, not quite that high, but just a little bit. And the reason why I do that is so that the weight of everything on the hi-hat stand is being supported by the legs and not by the pedal. When it's being supported by the pedal, then the pedal wobbles around a little bit. You guys see that? And that's really annoying. Okay, the top part of the hi-hat, right here. I'll talk about this piece in a little bit. This is a different piece. So, when you put this together, this part right here, inside of this tube screws into another part that looks like this that's down here. So I have to find it. And then when I find it, screw it together. And that's what allows it to go up and down. We'll be putting symbols on these in a little bit. All right, this is one of my symbol stands. I put a line here to help you remember how far apart I'd like to keep this. That's important because once I start putting it into place, if the legs are like this, then it's really wide and some of these legs might be in the way of other things. That's why I did that. So that's that one. I did the same thing on this stand. This is another stand. Now this stand is a little thicker than this one. I put heavier symbols on thicker stands. Thicker stands are heavier, so they stay put better than a thinner symbol stand. Heavy symbols are heavy, light symbols are light. I think it just makes sense to put heavy things on heavy things and light things on light things. So this is the top part of this stand. And I put a line here as well that helped me memorize how far up it went when I was using it. And I also have this piece here that I can adjust. And what I did is I put a line here and I just matched the two lines up so that I know what kind of angle I was using before when I used this. And I got the same thing over here. There should be a line here somewhere. There should be a line here somewhere. All right, so one symbol goes there, another symbol there. And then in here, I just, even though I got a pile of drumsticks over there already, I can keep some extra drumsticks here and always keep a shaker, just in case I need it. So I'm just gonna set this stuff aside. Symbols. I always keep extra drum heads with me. Why would I do that? You guys said the same thing. If I happen to break a drum head, then I have an extra one to put on there. Because most of the time when you're playing a gig, it's late at night somewhere, and most music stores aren't open. So if you break a drum head, you're kind of just out of luck. All right, cymbals. When you have your hi-hat cymbals, my labels and logos have been cleaned off because these are pretty old cymbals for me and I clean them every once in a while. But if you feel them, one of them feels heavier than the other one. The heavy one is the one that always goes on the bottom. The lighter one goes on top. Now on my cymbals, I put these things on here. This is not something that came on the cymbals. Why would I do this? Anybody have any idea? Yeah, the muffler. So by putting those on there, it still rings, but it muffles it just a little bit so it doesn't come across as loud as it would be otherwise. Let me rephrase this. Sometimes you have musicians standing around you on a small stage, and if you're playing your cymbals really loud, it can hurt their ears and overpower the mix. So I'll muffle them a little bit just to make sure that I stay not too loud. Okay. I don't know if I'm going to use those. On your, this is called a hi-hat clutch. You're always going to have three basic parts. You're going to have this piece here, which has basically a screw that goes all the way through. On the top part, you'll have something that you can adjust to lock down the cymbal, and you'll have a piece on the bottom that you can tighten to lock down the cymbal and keep it in place. Anytime you put a cymbal on something, it will always have a piece of felt on both sides of the cymbal. Otherwise, when metal vibrates against metal, it's going to sound pretty nasty. It's going to sound like a metal vibrating grinding kind of sound. Alright, so now that I have that put together, I'll sit down on my seat in relation to here, where I want to be, and then I'll put this where I want. Now for some performances, I'll use this thing. It's basically a tambourine, but it can go right here. But sometimes I like to hit the tambourine, so I'll actually turn it upside down so that I'm hitting the metal part instead of these like little jingles. When you flip it around and you hit the jingles themselves, these actually kind of break on you. I've broken a few over the years. I also like this so that when I do this, you get more of an extra chick kind of sound. All right. Now I got something new from a buddy of mine that's going to replace my felts. These are sim pads. It basically replaces the felt, but what it's supposed to do is last longer than the felt, and it's also supposed to help. It's supposed to help muffle the cymbals. And the colors mean nothing. They're just colors. So this is going to be where I put my smaller crash cymbal. Something with my ride cymbal that not a lot of people do is I will actually use my ride cymbal as a crash sometimes, and I'll show you that when I play on it. And that's a big reason why I put that there, because if I crash on a ride cymbal without any sort of muffling on it, then it just rings forever and it's not very pleasant. So hoping that these synth pads help a little bit. This is my first time using them. So normally, this is my full setup, and this is all I use. But for today, I'm going to add a couple things. I'm going to add another crash cymbal, which is what this is. Now I need to figure out exactly where I want to put this. So for now, I know I'm going to put it there, but I'll come back to that issue. Something else I know I'm going to do is I'm going to add this snare drum. We'll talk about that in a minute. And I'm going to add this splash cymbal. And this splash cymbal, I need to figure out where I want to put it. So usually when I play with a splash cymbal, I like to have it somewhere in this area, but on this drum set, I like to put this crash here. So I'm going to have to play with it a little bit and figure out where I want to put it. So for now, I'm just going to probably just do that. So the way this works is you have a clamp. It's already clamped onto this top part of another cymbal stand. So I'm going to clamp it onto this part of this cymbal stand. I'm going to come back and adjust it in a moment. I just wanted to get it up here out of the way. All right, that's fine for now. So let's talk about what has to happen with this. This is a small snare drum, and I don't know if you can see it from where you're at, but I haven't used it in a long time, so it's incredibly dusty and incredibly dirty. So I thought I'd take the opportunity to talk to you guys about how to clean that off. Now, if you had the perfect amount of time, what you would do is take this whole thing apart, clean everything individually, and then put it all back together. I don't have the time to do that right now. So here's what I'm going to do instead, is I'm going to take this splash cleaner, but it doesn't have to be this, it can be just like a general cleaner. You can spray it on a paper towel or a rag or something. Just start wiping just everywhere we see dirt. See all that? So I'm going to just kind of do a rough job on this. Just so it's not super nasty. And I'm going to come back and clean it for real some other time. Now, I did a lot of talking while I was setting this drum set up, But if I'm not explaining things to people and I go to set that drum set up, I want to see who can guess how long it actually takes me to set it up. What do you think, TJ?
7 minutes.
TJ thinks it takes 7 minutes for me to set up that whole drum set up just the way it is right now. Anybody else want to take a guess? Sorry? 10 minutes, Sam?
5 minutes?
All right, those are all really good guesses. I think normally when I set this drum set up, it takes me 3 to 5 minutes. Now that's a huge deal. That drum set there, Sean, when we pull that drum set out of a car and it's completely taken apart and we put it together for a gig, how long do you think it takes us to set it up? So it's like about 15 minutes. Now that's, maybe less. Now that's assuming that everything's kind of like sort of put together, like it's not in bags. Now you notice that all these things were completely disassembled and put in bags, right? But the biggest thing with that is I have those memory locks and those marks that I made, so I can put it together really quick. So if you took that drum set and you broke everything down, took all the cymbals off, took all the cymbal stands, and you broke them all down and everything, then it would probably take longer than 15 minutes, right? Plus, the stuff is in bags. Usually when we move that drum set, we just throw it in the back of somebody's car. So, all right, this drum set's, or snare drum's kind of more or less clean. Just nothing complicated. Now, these covers on these drums, basically PVC. What PVC is a type of plastic. So you can't really hurt this with like any cleaner. Now I would stay away from bleach because that's not necessary, and bleach could wash off logos, clothes, whatever. But any sort of general cleaner like this will get the dirt off and it won't hurt the drum at all. You can use the same thing on drum heads. Now the only thing you do have to worry about with drum heads is if you're cleaning off a drum head, a cleaner can also potentially take off any logos or markings that you might have on that drum head. And if that's important to you, you want to be careful of that. That's not particularly important to me these days, but it used to be. So if you look at the top of that head, I have a bunch of numbers written here. I actually used to use this drum to kind of help me remember forms of a song, the order of which the song was performed. So I wrote these numbers here to tell me how many measures each part was. But now it doesn't matter. That little circle there was done probably by TJ or one of my other kids. It's probably Dallas. TJ thinks it was Dallas. That's just that drum head. So it's been a while since I've used this. Now the main reason why I'm cleaning this off right now is it's not so much because like I care that much what it looks like. What I just did here does not impact the sound. It's because when I pick it up and move it around and stuff, I don't want to get dust and dirt all over my hands while I'm playing. All right, so this guy is going to go on this little side clamp wheel here. And unless anything changed, it should be exactly where I had it last time I used it. All right. So now we're kind of at a place where I can start making sure everything's where I want it to be, and then I can start playing for you guys. Anybody have the time?
Yeah.
All right, we're doing good. All right. Get this stuff out of the way. Now when you're going and you're playing a gig and you set up your drum set, you want to get all of your bags and stuff out of the way. So usually what I do is I take all of these extra bags and I throw them inside this one bag and just put this back in my car. It's usually what I do. Okay. Now my cymbal bag has another purpose. I will usually, instead of putting this in my car, put my cymbal bag right here. And I will take my extra drumsticks and put it in the small pocket of my cymbal bag. And just lean it up against this stuff back here. Because if I drop a drumstick, then all I have to do is pick up another one right here. Now they do make stick holders and all sorts of other things you can use. But if I brought a stick holder here, that would just be one more thing I'd have to carry. But I already have my cymbal bag, so that's why I use my cymbal bag. All right, so now that I have my drum set set up, I'm gonna go around and make sure everything is the way I want it to sound. I'm also gonna look to see if there's anything I want to adjust. I already know that I want my ride cymbal there because I'm just used to it being there in that space. So here's some things that I look at. These drums are already where I want them to be. But if I was setting it up from scratch, first thing I do is I put the bass drum where I want it. Then I sit down on my seat and I put my right foot where I want it on the bass drum. Now if I sit too close, then my knee is going to be kind of on a weird, awkward position. If I sit too far away, then I have to like reach out for stuff. So what I usually try to do is I try to sit in this position. So if I sit too close, what ends up happening is I end up being like this with my knee. What I was trying to talk about. If I sit too far away, then I have to be like that. That's uncomfortable too. So I try to be straight up and down with this leg, and I like to sit a little bit above here. You know, if this is 90 degrees or a right angle, I like to be a little bit bigger than that. I like to feel like I'm on top of my drums. If I sit with my legs like this, then I feel like I'm underneath my drums. It's hard for me to play. And by the way, with my drum seat, I make sure everything is locked down except for the top part. I like that it can spin so that if I move around a little bit, then it just moves with me when I'm playing. It just makes me more comfortable. That's my personal preference. Okay, so now I'm sitting the way I want to sit. The hi-hat's where I want to have it. Now what I worry about next are the drums. If I were to drop my hands at my side, and bend only at my elbows and put my stick tips together, I like for that to be where the center of my snare drum is. Because I spend a lot of time on the snare drum and I just want it to be super comfortable to play. If I sit too close, my arms get pulled back. If I sit too far away, then I have to reach forward. And neither of those is comfortable. Then, my floor tom, if I just move my body this way, I like to have the stick tips right lined up in the middle of the floor tom. So now I don't have to reach or pull back for anything. I just have to turn my body. This drum I don't use a whole lot, so I don't mind reaching a little bit for it. So that's cool with me. So, I'm very happy with all this. Now I have an extra snare drum here. Same principle with this as with the floor tom. I'm not going to hit this snare drum as much as this one, but all I want to do is just be able to turn my body and hit the middle of it. Which I can right now. So now let's talk about cymbals. The hi-hat's already where I want to have it. I don't have to reach for it or pull back for it. All I have to do is go there. Now I think I got lucky on this because this is actually about perfect. I'm happy with that. I don't have to really reach for it. This I have to reach for, but I'm not going to be spending a whole lot of time on this crash cymbal. So reaching for it a little bit is not that big of a deal, but it's not even that much of a reach. From here to here, it's just moving my arm a little bit. Ride cymbal. All I have to do is that. I rarely will play this cymbal with my left hand, so I'm not really concerned about what happens with my left hand over here. My right hand, just all I have to do is move it over. So I'm cool with all that. Check out what happens to my arm right here. It doesn't really move. All I'm doing is moving my forearm where I want it. You guys see that? So I know this is like kind of like not that interesting stuff, but this is what keeps me from getting tired when I play or being uncomfortable when I play. Everything I can do now is comfortable for me. Cool, so I'm happy with all that. So let's talk about drum sounds. I'm content with that, I'm not gonna mess with it right now. Interestingly enough, I'm pretty happy with the way those two toms sound right now. That doesn't mean that they're perfect, but I expected them to be way more out of tune than that. This snare drum I'm not too crazy about, but I already know why. Because I don't like the drum head that's on the top. You can buy different drum heads to achieve different types of sounds. Do you guys notice the drum head on this one was white? This one has a white powder coating on it. It's kind of like a paint that changes the way the drum set sounds a little bit. This drum right here is clear. Let me take it off for you. You see that line around the perimeter of it, the edge of it? Now this is actually a two-ply drum head that is also textured. It's supposed to make it a little bit muffled. And I put this drum head on here a while ago just to see what I thought of the sound of it. And I decided I didn't like it a whole lot, but I'm not gonna change it today. It doesn't sound terrible. I just know that this snare drum can sound better with a different head on it. Okay, so I'm actually pretty happy with the way these drums sound. Here's what I'm looking for. At the bottom end of the day with these drums is I want them to sound very different from each other. I want the bass drum to be the lowest one. Very punchy. I want this snare drum to sound very different than that. I want it to be very high and kind of like a shotgun sound. Now the difference between this snare drum and this one is I want this one to sound like a lot higher in pitch but kind of like teeny. It doesn't have a lot of body to it, it's just very high sounding. And then with the two toms, I want one to sound high, one to sound low. But I want this to still be higher than my bass drum. So I have four drums that sound very different from each other. To me, that's very musical and awesome. Probably gonna have to walk in. Oh, you're good there, that's fine. All right, cool. Now the only thing I wanna do right now is change the bass drum up a little bit. All right, so I'm noticing with this pedal already that it's got an issue with it that I can't really adjust, so I'm gonna see if that other pedal's in here. Which, is, of course it's not, so. I'm kind of stuck with it. Where'd that come in? So this side of the bass drum is a little floppy sounding to me, so I'm going to tighten it just a little bit with that drum key. And we're almost done with this part. I'll start doing some playing soon. Anybody have any questions?
Is the length of that bass drum, is that purely because to be able to pack the other drum?
It's actually a really good question. So your actual pitch is three different parts of the drum. One head, the other head, and the shell. Those three things contribute to the sound of any drum. Now with a bass drum, a drum head can only get so low, and you usually want your bass drum to be pretty low. Now this drum, because it's a smaller drum head, it's not going to be able to get as low as a bigger drum head like on that drum set over there. However, the length of the bass drum will contribute more to the frequencies that come out. So if you think of it in terms of like the EQ on your stereo, like the highs, the mids, and the lows, the longer bass drum shell will actually bring up the lows, will bring the lows out more. So what actually is created here is by having a smaller diameter, you're creating a punchier sound, and technically it's not as low, but the lower frequencies will come out. On a bigger bass drum like that, you're going to get a lot of low frequencies out of the drum head, but because the shell depth is so shallow, you're not really capturing that as well. It's going to sound kind of thin. So when you hit that drum, you're really getting a lot of head sound and not a lot of shell sound. On this drum, you get a lot of shell sound. So what I'm actually looking to do right now is I tighten this drum head up a little bit, because I'm hoping to get the shell to resonate a little bit more. And now I need to work on this side to see what kind of sound I have here. There's not a lot of resonance coming out of that, so I'm going to tighten it up a little bit. And what I'm doing right now is I'm hunting for the tension rods that seem really loose to me. Because I don't want to make this too tight. I just want to have a little bit more resonance out of this head. A little bit more. Now, I don't know if you guys have noticed this, but you notice when I hit this bass drum, it's not ringing very much because of the sticker that's on here. I haven't even put this towel in here yet. I got this towel in there. So I think I'm going to have to play with this more to get happy with it, but I'm going to leave it alone for now. One thing's for sure is that bass drum sounds more alive than it did before. It wasn't so dead sounding. Alright. So just to be consistent, I'm going to change this out real quick. And then we're going to put a microphone in this bass drum and talk about that. That's a good question too. Most places that you play at, if it's a small venue, like a restaurant or a small club, usually they will not have their own PA system or sound system, like what you see here with these speakers. So usually the band has to bring their own. Now a small venue like that, there will be no need to mic any of the drums. But sometimes you will bring one mic, and this is a bass drum mic. Bass drum mics are usually a little fatter. And I will do this just to add more volume to the bass drum. Now sometimes it can be mounted on a stand like that. I just don't even bother since I do this whole towel thing. I just put it in here and rest it on the towel. Just like that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit this bass drum a few times with no volume coming out of the microphone. Now I'm going to add some volume. You guys hear the difference? So what I have going on here is I got a very small mixer, and the mixer is going to this little amp and this little amp over here. Gives it a little bit more oomph. And when you're playing with a band, that's really helpful because that bass drum can get lost a lot when a band's playing live. But I don't bother miking this stuff usually because it's loud. Now, if it's a bigger venue, they will usually have their own sound system at the venue, and they'll usually have their own sound guy at the venue who will usually have his own microphones that you can put on the drums. All right, I think we're ready to go here. You guys have any questions about any of the stuff I talked about? All right. Now, I don't know if I'm going to use this But I just brought this gong out here for fun. So for some bands, mainly my heavier bands, I actually will use a gong, but I don't really use it the way that other people use it. I use it like it's a crash cymbal. I don't really use it for like big dramatic effect. Is that where I want it? Almost. All right. All right, so what I'm gonna do first before I start getting playing into some songs, I'm just gonna play around a little bit on this drum set that we just set up together. And play just some different styles of things, hit some different cymbals, let you guys see some different things that you don't normally get to see, being that a lot of you guys are younger players. Something else I wanted to show you guys, and I don't think I'm going to use them today, but sometimes I have to play extremely quiet, and one way to do that is just by playing really quiet. So playing a little quieter is going to get me kind of there, but another thing I can do is I can muffle the drums a whole lot more. And so there's this product that I like a lot called Moon Gels, and I'm not really sure how to describe it. It's kind of like a, I don't know what you'd call it. It's a gel type thing that you can stick on your drums. And it's like, it's kind of weird because it's kind of sticky, but at the same time it's like, it's not like a sticker. It clings to your drums. And when you put them on your drum heads, it will muffle them significantly. And so I'm just going to do that. Now that I'm playing quieter, I need to lower that bass drum. You guys notice the difference in the sound? And now it sounds totally different. It sounds like a toy to me, so we're not going to do that anymore. All right. So most of you guys, we've done some free playing, or I've shown you some drum beats to a bunch of songs. Like, we've been playing like Turn Down For What, and we've been doing Fancy by Iggy Azalea and some Katy Perry songs and things like that. So I thought what I'd do is play some of those songs along with some of those songs on this drum set. And in between, if you guys have any questions, we can talk about that, or if there's something unique about the song I want to talk to you guys about, we can do that too. Okay, so all of these songs, there's basically, in my mind, two ways to do it. One way is, if you're playing along with the song, is you can do it exactly the way the drummer on the song's doing it. And I think there's a lot of value to doing that. If you can learn to play the way a drummer's playing, then you're going to learn something from that. Learn something about that drummer's style, about the style of that music. Maybe learn some fills or drum beats that you don't know. So I think there's value to that. But I'm not really going to be doing that. I'm just going to kind of improvise a lot. Who knows what improvise means? Somebody in here knows. Preferably a student. Let's get some guesses. What does improvise mean? Somebody knows. All right, what do you think?
Substitute.
Substitute's not a bad word. Let's hold on to that. I'll use that when I talk about it. Coming up with something on the spot. What were you going to say? Making it up. All right, I like all of those. So when you're improvising, what you're doing is you're pulling from the knowledge that you have of drum parts that you know, or rudiments that you know, or fills that you know, and you're pulling it into your playing on the spot. You're making it up on the spot, pulling it out, and what you're doing, Satya, is you're substituting the real drum part for the other stuff that you're pulling out on the spot. So all of those are good explanations for it. So when I say that I'm improvising, I'm pulling from the knowledge that I already have, and I'm going to play not the part that's on the recording, I'm going to play a different part that's fun for me and just have fun with it. And this is what I encourage you guys to do a lot at home. However, let me tell you this. If I'm playing these songs live with a band, I will never ever play it the way that I'm going to play it right now. The reason why is I'm playing a part that fits in with the groove that's already happening. If I play these parts with a live band, it's probably not going to be there. The groove or the drum beat that needs to happen for that song to make it sound good live isn't going to be there. It's not going to happen. So what I'm about to do is not how I would do it in a live band situation. It's just how I would do it at home in my bedroom for fun. And what I usually try to do is, not only do I try to play things that I think sound good, but usually I try to challenge myself by giving myself sort of assignments, like, okay, I'm gonna work on this kind of fill, maybe it's something involving this rhythm. Or something like that. I might say to myself, okay, I wanna work on that rhythm, so I'm gonna try to find ways to put it into a song. Or I might say, okay, I wanna work on playing doubles with my hand and with my foot. So, for example, those are doubles with my hand and my foot. So that might be the thing that I'm working on. So usually I have things that I'm trying to work on. And I want you guys to think about it that way at home too, to say, okay, I want to try this thing and see if I can just find ways to make it work in a song. All right. Any questions about anything I talked about before I play the first song? No? All right. Now I am pulling these off of YouTube, so we'll have to bear with some commercials here. Okay, so I'm going to do this song called Turn Down for What. It's got a snare drum part that happens a couple times. It's pretty cool. And then the drums actually in this song aren't very busy, but I'm going to play it pretty busy. So like I said, the way that I'm going to do it is not the way you would do it live. All right, here we go. So, clap. Not because I need to hear your clapping, but what you guys should be accustomed to is whenever people are performing to you, you want to, you know, that shows them that you appreciate what they just did, okay? So you guys need to be in the habit of that. All right, do you guys have any questions or comments about anything I did in there? Let me ask you this first. I can barely hear these speakers, but they're probably pretty loud to you. Did you guys feel like you could hear everything? All right, so what I'm going to do... Move these
you
around.
Are definitely a lot louder than the music.
I am?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't want to blow you guys away, but I don't really want to play too soft. All right, so I'll just start playing this one. that is so cool. You guys want to hear what's cool? Guess what happens when you don't keep your computer plugged in? Yeah, so that's fine. All right, cool. All right, so then since that's doing its thing, we'll let that boot back up. These two songs here, the first one turned out for what and this one, they're both what we might call like hip hop style. I mean, I know like the second one, the Iggy one, is like more rap or whatever, but like it's still a hip hop genre. And I've never, like, when I was growing up, I never like was like totally into rap and stuff, but I always really appreciated it for the drumming and for the rhythmic stuff that happened in all the songs. So I do feel kind of drawn to it, and I really like that when we're talking about improvising, that a lot of these songs are very easy to improvise with because they're already so rhythmic and almost anything you do fits with it. And if you guys notice, like, I was playing a lot of different types of grooves with both of those songs. Can you get to the restroom?
Sorry.
We're going to have to parade you in front of everybody to get there. Alright. So I really like hip-hop songs for that. Like, a lot of hip-hop songs are really good for just jamming too. Okay, so while we're doing this, one of the things I was going to ask you guys about is if you had any requests for songs that you like that you want me to play along with. Chris?
Welcome to the Family by Insecto.
Now, I could do that, but what makes it challenging, that song have bad words in it?
Yes.
Huh? If it does, I can't do it. Verdict on that?
I don't know. I'm going to put the verdict.
All right, so he's looking that up. Anybody else? Any song that you like? All right, so I'm going to skip that Iggy song and move on to another one. All right. So the reason why I said that it was awesome when my computer died is we just learned something. What did we learn? Yeah, and you know, something else that was happening, I don't know if you guys noticed this, but I failed to really pay attention to what was going on with my hi-hat here when I set it up. So this became loose, and so did this, as I was playing. And so, you know, before you start playing any gig or anything, you should go around and just make sure everything is tight, so that while you're playing, things don't move around on you. Which also includes, if you're playing along with a computer, make sure you got your stuff plugged in, right?
Ziggy Eats. I got one more problem with your best friend.
We'll be right back.
Hate this song, but this would be a great example of a song that I don't feel like you can improvise a whole lot around. So I'm gonna play it a little bit, and then I'm gonna stop. It's like I kind of like the song, but I kind of don't like it that much. So you guys probably feel the same. All right.
Available at Target.
This is Chris's favorite song. The thing is with that song is that drum beat right there is what makes that entire song. And I don't know if you guys noticed, but I played the entire same thing in that song. So there's nothing wrong with that. That's just the way some songs are. Some songs just need that beat to be what it is. And I could goof around it, but it won't make the song sound any better. In fact, make it sound a lot worse. All right, this song I will play. This is kind of a, from a musical perspective, I think this song's pretty interesting. By the way, I'm not telling you guys the names of these songs. Who knows what that last song was? What's that? Shake It Off. Who's that by? Yeah, Jacob, do it. That's fine. Yeah, I think it's, even if you don't like certain songs, I think it's important that you guys know what things are when you hear it, especially if you're studying music. Like, know that that's Taylor Swift. Know that that's JoJo or, what's his name, John Mayer, or know if it's Avenged Sevenfold. Like, even if you don't like stuff, like, learn what things are. All right, I'll do a little bit. I don't know. This is Rude by Magic. I know you've heard it on the radio.
Saturday morning, jumped out of bed, put on my best suit, got in my car, raced like a jet, on my way to the moon. I'm going up the road with heart in my head, the words you could
couple things I want to bring to you guys' attention is this has got like what I would call like a pseudo reggae feel to it. It's not a pure reggae beat, but this part. What's coming from here? What's that louder note called that I'm playing? Some of you guys know this. It's an accent. I could play it this way. Now listen to what happens when I put that accent in there. Way it feels, changes the way it sounds. There's a technique in here we call a cross stick. And what I'm actually doing is I'm putting the back end of the stick on the drum head and I'm coming down like this, but I'm not lifting this off the drum at all. And it creates kind of this knocking sound. So that's the part where I was doing this. So that sounds pretty interesting, it's just different. Alright, this song, I'm just going to go on a limb and say it's Jacob Sturvey's favorite song. Maybe, we'll see. Alright. This is another one of those songs where you can't, I don't feel like you can improvise a whole lot around it and keep the same feel of the song. I wouldn't call it a hip hop song at all. It's got kind of like an old, like 50s, I don't know, like doo-wop or rock and roll vibe to it. Even though it's got a hip hop influence.
Because you know I'm all about that bass, no trouble. I'm all about that bass, no trouble. I'm all about that bass. Come on.
You like that song, Jacob, right? That's kind of a cool song, you have to admit it. They say booty in it.
His mom likes it, so I'll give it.
Alright, so there's like a bunch of other songs I could play, but I'd rather see if you guys have anything that you want to hear me play and mess around with. Even if it's something you think I don't know, I'll give it a shot. Did you look at those lyrics?
Oh yeah, I didn't see any bad words.
Alright, then we'll do that. So he wants me to play this metal song. Actually, before I do that, the drum beat for this song that I just played goes like this. That's pretty much what it is the whole time, and then there's some fills and stuff. But did you guys notice in this song that there's some like quiet parts and then some loud parts? Well, the way that I do that on drums is, yes, I can play louder and softer, but by the way that I change the hi-hat, I can make it sound like it's louder or more intense because of what I'm doing with the hi-hat. So check this out. That's pretty mellow. So, by opening the hi-hat and changing how I'm playing on the hi-hat, I gave it more intensity to make it sound like the song was louder or moving forward with more intensity, but I'm still playing the same beat. So it's kind of like that other song, that Root song I was playing, where I changed what the hi-hat was doing, and it just changed the way it felt or felt, even though it's kind of technically the same thing. So he wants me to do this metal song that's usually done on a very large drum set. So what I can do is take what I know of playing this song on a large drum set and sort of compact it down into a smaller drum set and still play the same style. See, you can have a small drum set and play a heavy style of music, or you can have a big drum set and play a very light style of music. You guys ever heard of a band called Florida Georgia Line? They have this song called Cruise. You know that song? I'll look it up and play a little bit of it for you. Now this guy, who plays drums for this band, see, these country bands usually have small drum sets like kind of like this, or like that one over there. But this guy, he's got a drum set that has three bass drums and like seven tom-toms and a whole bunch of cymbals. He's got this big heavy metal looking drum set, but he's playing country music. Why would he do that? Probably just for show, probably just for entertainment, because I know he's not using all of those. So you can play a big kit but sound small. You can play a small kit like this and sound big. So I'm going to play a little bit of Cruise, and then we'll play your song, okay? Talk to most people who know something about music, they would probably not really call that country. They'd probably call it country rock. That's probably a better genre for them. So it's a heavier version of country music, but this guy has this huge drum set, but this is really all you need. You don't need all that. So what is that song called, Chris? Now, I can't remember how long this song is. If it's really long, I'll only play some of it. That's 4 minutes, I'll play it. Now while I'm doing this song, I really want want to hear suggestions from other people, like other songs. So while I'm doing this, try to think of another song or two, because we only have about 15 minutes left, and then we're going to be done with what we're doing here. You have a song? All right, let me finish this. Remember that song, okay? Now, Chris, I don't think I've played this song in years, so bear with me. I know I'll remember some of it. Stop at that, but there's a part in there that requires two bass drums or a double bass drum pedal. I only have this set up for safety. Why might I want two bass drums or a double bass drum pedal? Somebody who doesn't know, like Kavina, why might I want two? You've seen me use it in the room over there. Why would I use two? Say it again. She said to make the beat more complicated. That's partially true, but it's not always to make it more complicated. Sometimes I might want two bass drums because I need to play a bass drum part that I can only accomplish with 2 feet. I can only play so fast with 1 foot. With 2 feet, it sounds kind of like that. So, I wish I could play the whole thing, but I can barely hear it, and I don't want to blow everybody away. All right, what song did you come up with? Oh, that one? All right. We will do, I'll do some of them. Anybody else have any song ideas? All right, we'll have to do this more often so you guys aren't so shy. Any other ideas? DJ, you got something? Now this one's interesting because it's like kind of like one of those songs where you can improvise around it, but if you change it too much, it's not really going to sound like the song, and it's not like real drumming. It's kind of like a couple bass drums, but I'm going to play it like it's a drum set part. do one more song, unless people have questions about things. Nope. One more song. Let's pick a song. Somebody come up with something. What do you got? Yeah, I want to hear from you. Come on, Cameron. You don't have a song? Do you know any songs that he likes? Oh, did I play all of them? All right. Let's see.
I have a comment.
Okay.
Not so much on the last couple songs, but towards the beginning, you get pretty wild with your left foot there on the hi-hat.
Actually, most of the time, I'm just kind of bobbing it. Most of the time, I'm not even thinking about it. But sometimes, like some of the earlier songs I did, I was actually doing some specific things with my left foot.
That there was actually making a special sound.
Yeah. And I'll do this a lot sometimes, but like I'm not even really paying attention to it most of the time anymore. That's not a good or bad thing, it's just something that I do. And even if I'm not really doing much, I'm still doing this a little bit. Like when I play music like I think some people like to dance. Like I'm not much of a dancer, I'm not into feeling my body and stuff. But when I play drums, like my whole body's involved in it, so like everything's kind of always moving. This is like my version of dancing, if you want to put it that way. So I can't really hold this still when I play. Like, plus, it would look kind of boring if I just did this. I think it's more fun to be kind of move around when you play. Yes. What song? Huh? All right. I'm not even sure if I've ever played it. I definitely know the song. So we'll see how it goes. Bon Jovi, right? We'll be right back. definitely do that song, but I don't think I've ever played that before this, so that was kind of a fun challenge. Alright guys, so we're going to wrap up. You guys have any questions or comments about anything I did before you leave? Don't go anywhere yet. Nothing? Okay, so the practical side to doing this, oh, you had a question.
Where did you get the
So I designed that on a computer, and then I sent it to a sign company who basically printed out a big sticker, and then they put it on there. And then I cut the hole.
And they cut the hole too?
I cut the hole. And I did a pretty terrible job of it too, by the way, which is why I put that little piece of tape there to make it look a little bit better. Sean was there when I messed it up. They make special tools that allow you to make like a perfect circle to cut it through. And when I did it, the head moved, so it's like not perfect, but it looks okay. That's the answer to your question. Anything else? And that cost actually like $33 to do. It wasn't very expensive. So the practical side to doing this was to give you guys something to do with me while we have the rest of the week that we're closed because of the holiday. But I should probably do things like this more often because I know you guys rarely get an opportunity to see me play. And I know that sometimes when I bring in clinicians, it's sometimes they're in the evening and it's hard for you guys to make it. So I'm going to try to do more stuff like this, but here's what I need you guys to do for me. Is I need you guys to think more about not just your drumming, but also think about things like what you saw here. And like when I see you during your lessons or during your classes, think about things that you saw here, and if questions pop up, ask me about those things. Because that'll help me sort of to put together workshops for the future that I think you guys might be interested in. Here's another way to think about it. If there's stuff that you really liked about what I did tonight, please let me know about that later, and I keep that in mind when I do things like this in the future. If there are things that you thought were completely boring and you're not that interested in, I want to hear that too. You'll never offend me. Like, if you don't like certain things, then let me know. If you do like certain things, let me know that. That way I can do this better in the future for you guys. Cool? All right, any last questions or comments or anything? All right, the pieces of paper that I left on the chairs, if you guys could just toss that in the trash on the way out, that would be helpful and everything else can stay right where it is. You guys have a great Thanksgiving and I'll see you guys after the break. Bye guys.